Good morning.
Good morning.
I want to welcome you as we gather for worship on this second Sunday of Easter. We continue to celebrate Christ's resurrection in our worship services. Let us rise for the invocation and Easter acclamation. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
He has risen indeed. Hallelujah.
He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. Taking refuge in the mercy of the Lord, let us come before him in prayer. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By the things we have done and by what we have failed to do, we have not honored you as we ought, nor have we served others in love. We deserve to be cast from your presence forever. Yet in your great mercy, you sent your Son to die and rise again for us. Help us to know the power of his resurrection and to share in the joy that his forgiveness brings. Enable us to receive your mercy and be renewed by your Spirit, that we may honor you as the Lord and God in whom we place our trust. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, hears our prayers and answers them for the sake of his Son, Jesus Christ. By faith, we stand at his cross and empty tomb. We find our refuge and sing for joy in the shadow of his wings. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world and for the well-being of the Church of God and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, grant that we, who have celebrated the Lord's resurrection, may by your grace confess in our life and conversation that Jesus is Lord and God. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
You may be seated. The first reading is recorded in the 5th chapter of the book of Acts. Now many signs and wonders were regularly done among the people by the hands of the apostles, and they were all together in Solomon's portico. None of the rest dared join them, but the people held them in high esteem. And more than ever, believers were added to the Lord, multitudes of both men and women, so that they even carried out the sick into the streets and laid them on cots and mats, that as Peter came by, at least his shadow might fall on some of them. The people also gathered from the towns around Jerusalem, and bringing the sick and those afflicted with unclean spirits, and they were all healed. But the high priest rose up, and all who were with him, that is, the party of the Sadducees, and filled with jealousy, they arrested the apostles and put them in the public prison. But during the night, an angel of the Lord opened the prison doors and brought them out and said, "Go and stand in the temple and speak to the people all the words of this life." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle is recorded in Revelation chapter 1. John, to the seven churches that are in Asia, grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of kings on earth, to him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood, and made us a kingdom, priests to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And all tribes of the earth will wail on account of him. Even so, amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. I, John, your brother and partner in the tribulation and the kingdom and the patient endurance that are in Jesus, was on the island called Patmos on account of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet saying, "Write what you see in a book and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus and to Smyrna, and to Pergamum, and to Thyatira, and to Sardis, and to Philadelphia, and to Laodicea." Then I turned to see the voice that was speaking to me. And on turning, I saw seven golden lampstands, and in the midst of the lampstands, one like a son of man, clothed with a long robe and with a golden sash around his chest. The hairs of his head were white like wool, as white as snow. His eyes were like a flame of fire. His feet were like burnished bronze refined in a furnace, and his voice was like the roar of many waters. In his right hand he held seven stars. From his mouth came a sharp two-edged sword, and his face was like the sun shining in full strength. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. But he laid his right hand on me, saying, "Fear not, I am the first and the last, and the living one. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and Hades." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please rise for the verse. Hallelujah. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Blessed are those who have not seen. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 20th chapter. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of anyone, they are forgiven. If you withhold forgiveness from anyone, it is withheld. Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails and place my finger into the mark of the nails and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. I'd like to invite any of the children to come forward for an object lesson. So you can come on up and sit down on the cushion. So last Sunday was Easter, when Jesus rose from the dead. And you know, sometimes it's a hard thing for people to believe that someone who was put to death like Jesus was could be alive again just 3 days later. It's a hard thing to believe. Now I have a box here. Isn't this a pretty box? Now would you believe that in this box, I have an object that brings a smile to many faces? And if you use this, people are going to want to touch it. But if you touch it, it will disappear. Do you believe that? You do? I'm so glad they believe that, because that's a hard thing to believe. If I touch this, will it disappear? No, it's still there. If I touch my head, will I disappear? No, you're right, I won't disappear. But this product, which when people see it, will bring a smile to many faces, and when you use it, people will want to touch it, but if you touch it, it will disappear. You want to see what it is? Oh, maybe I'll just wait until next week. No? You want it today? Let's see what it is. Look what I got. You know what that is? Yeah. Let's use it. Okay? Take the top off. Now what? Let's watch what happens. And I touched it. What happened to it? It disappeared. Oh, let's see if I do it. I did this way back before the pandemic once, and we had a lot of children up here, and I began to blow bubbles, and all of a sudden the children jumped up. They all wanted to pop the bubbles I made. Here's another one. I'll touch it. Ah, it disappeared. Let's see what happens this way. Watch. Uh-oh, look at those bubbles.
They're sticky.
Yeah, they all popped. Do you know what? To help you remember this, when church is over, I got one of these for each one of you. Okay? But it'll be after church. You take them home. When you get home, maybe mom or dad can open the bottle because these are hard to open. And you can maybe go outside and blow some bubbles and enjoy that. But you know, just like I said something that may have been hard to believe, Knowing that Jesus is alive was hard to believe at first, but they learned that Jesus is alive. And we don't worship a dead Jesus, but a living one who is our Savior. And I want to thank you so much for coming up. You can go back to your seats. And I invite the congregation to rise as we profess our faith with the words of Martin Luther's explanation of the second article of the Apostles' Creed. I believe that Jesus Christ, true God, begotten of the Father from eternity, and also true man, born of the Virgin Mary, is my Lord, who has redeemed me, a lost and condemned person, purchased and won me from all sins, from death, and from the power of the devil, not with gold or silver, but with his holy precious blood, and with his innocent suffering and death, that I may be his own and live under him in his kingdom, and serve him in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness, just as he is risen from the dead, lives and reigns to all eternity. This is most certainly true. You may be seated. I'd like to begin by addressing the old people here today. What were you doing on July 21st, 1969? Do you remember what you were doing?
Watching the man on the moon.
Yeah, exactly. Watching them step off the spaceship thing and go down onto the moon's surface, and you hear Neil Armstrong say those immortal words. One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. But do you know, there are some people who think that never happened. They think it was done in a studio. It's amazing. Here's another one. There are people who think the Holocaust never happened. I know they don't teach you much anymore, but the Holocaust happened was when 6 million Jews were put to death by Adolf Hitler and his Nazi regime. And there's so much evidence pointing to the fact of that, and yet, in spite of that, there are people who don't believe it ever happened. Here's another one. There's a professor down in Florida. I'm not going to say his name. I don't think it's worthy to give him that credit. But he believes that the massacre at Sandy Hook never took place. He believes that's fiction. It never happened. How sad. All he had to do was go to one of the funerals. All he had to do was talk to any of the people who were in that school to deal with the results of that evil violence that occurred. I believe it happened. I also know a couple of people who actually were in that school and saw the results of that evil act. And I know a retired pastor who had a grandchild in that school when it happened, but in a different classroom. But there's a lot of things that some people may say didn't happen, didn't occur. Sounds a lot like Thomas, right? With the resurrection of Jesus. I don't believe he's alive. Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails and place my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will never believe. That's what Thomas said. He was so convinced that Jesus was still dead, he would not believe, even though the disciples said to him, "We have seen the Lord." I do know the resurrection of Jesus is a challenging thing to believe. To believe that he who was so severely put to death, crucified, buried in a tomb, and then on Easter morning rise again. The resurrection sometimes causes people to stumble. You know, in Great Britain, a quarter of people who profess to be Christian do not believe in the resurrection. In my opinion, why even have faith? What good is it? St. Paul said, if Christ is not raised, your faith is futile. You're still in your sins. But still to imagine. You know, I've had known of people who think, well, his body didn't rise, but Jesus is alive. That's not a resurrection. The Bible teaches that the body of Jesus that was nailed to that cross, that died on that cross, that was buried in that tomb, came back to life on Easter morning, raised again. And that is an important teaching for us to believe and to understand. We may not truly grasp everything, but this is how God does things. You know, Jesus didn't just appear to everybody after he rose again. The first person who saw him was Mary Magdalene, and then the women. And when they saw him, what did they do? They run back to the disciples, and the first thing they said, "We have seen the Lord, we have seen the Lord." And what did they say? "Oh, great!" No, they didn't believe him. They did not believe him. Until that Easter evening when Jesus appeared in their midst, in the middle of them, in that room behind locked doors. And they were so startled. Luke says that Jesus asked for something to eat because they thought he was a ghost. It wasn't a ghost. It was Jesus in his body, a glorified body that could appear, but the same body that was nailed to the cross. He was alive and risen from the dead. And what did they do? Those disciples told Thomas, who wasn't with them, "Thomas, we have seen the Lord." Look at his attitude. No way. No way. But this is how God works. In a way, Thomas is almost representing the church down the road to hear the news. But instead of saying, "No way," to hear the news and to receive it with joy and with faith. It took Thomas the ability to see Jesus with his own eyes and the ability to touch him with his own hands before he would even believe. But Jesus said something to Thomas. He said, because you have seen me, you believe. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. That category has to do with you and me. We don't have the luxury of seeing Jesus in his body with our own eyes and touching him with our hands. We do have the privilege of receiving him in the holy sacrament of his supper when he feeds us with his body and blood in these forms of bread and wine. But to see him as they saw him, no. We believe because we hear the message. And that's how Jesus was setting it up. He used Mary. What did she say? I've seen the Lord. The women, we have seen the Lord. The disciples of Thomas, we have seen the Lord. And down the road, there's somebody who is telling us that Jesus Christ is alive and risen from the dead. So that we could believe as well. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. He said, because I live, you too shall live. Because he is risen from the dead, we know that we too who believe in him will live forever. St. Paul put it this way, that Jesus was crucified for our transgressions and was raised for our justification. And as we gather in this place to celebrate the crucified and risen Christ, we know that we are justified by the act that Jesus performed, giving his life on that cross and being raised again for that justification. That's pretty good news, isn't it? And we like to share good news with people. I hope that you can share that news with your family members who may be struggling in their faith. I hope that you place that good news in your heart and in your life as you're living your life on this side of heaven. That you realize that you are not living it alone, but that Jesus has already accomplished a victory for you, something that can help motivate you in life and keep your life in the proper perspective. And then maybe other people can see the kind of confidence you have as you live your life, knowing that God has loved you so much that he not only gave up Jesus to pay for your sins, but he raised him from the dead as a living Lord who continues to live for you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The flowers on the altar are given by Debbie Morrow and family in memory of Mary LaBrie, who went to heaven 30 years ago on April 20th. The eternal light is lit in memory of Mary LaBrie by Debbie Morrow.